I was going to stand at the bottom, but they've asked me to stand at the top. I have the beautiful job of talking to you about the psychology of peak performance. I also have the very dangerous job of being in this precarious position that's keeping you away from dinner. So that is an interesting position. So I'm a performance coach, and my job is to optimize the human body and mind. And I do this for athletes. I've been doing this for athletes for 20 years. And I look at thousands of different variables. And my job is to engineer it in a way in which I'm getting the opportunity to fully unlock human potential. Now, 20 years of doing that was very interesting. What was more interesting was the last 2 years. In the last 2 years, there's been anxiety, fear, panic, stress. And as a psychologist, as a performance coach, we made one very grave mistake. One grave mistake we made was we ignored all of that and we pushed ourselves to try to outperform
preconditions.
You know, we ignored the fear, ignored the anxiety, ignored the panic, ignored the uncertainty in the environment, and we said, you got to perform, you got to perform, you got to perform. And what happened to me, what happened to my athletes, and I'm sure what's happened to many of you all, is the mind fractured in some shape and form. How many of you know what I'm talking about? In the last 2 years, so much has changed. You weren't able to even understand or recognize what you're feeling, and you forced yourself, you kept saying to yourself, I got to do better, I got to do better. You kept blaming yourself for everything. Anyone understand what I talk about? No one. Amazing. My athletes, I wish my athletes were that lucky. They're not. But I want to talk about something else that's really amazing that happened in the last 2 years. What happened in the last 2 years, I'm not here to talk about mental health. I'm here to talk about the psychology of performance. And the year 2021, in the middle of the lockdown, we had more records being broken than ever before. Okay, can you imagine that? Right? In the middle of a lockdown. Now, why do you think that happened? And that happened because of an individual's relationship to stress. That's why. For the first time in the history of sport, going back to the first Olympics, right up to now, it was the first time a practice environment and a competition environment mimicked each other. Right? There were no spectators in the stands, there was no watching, there was no media, there was no press. The same ecosystem in which we practiced, we just showed up and we played. And for the first time, young athletes who were physically stronger won. Because why? Experience was taken out of the window because there was no pressure anymore. Right? Experience comes into play when you're dealing with pressure situations. And that's very, very interesting. And the reason I want to start with that one point before I go into this whole experience is really over the course of this talk, I'm going to give you a few interesting exercises, a few interesting insights. But one should really evaluate their relationship to pressure. Okay. Now, when I start any talk, I like to get to know my audience. So we're going to do a little exercise, not a physical exercise. I'm not going to get you to run, but I need to know who I'm talking to. Okay. So everyone, hold your hands up like this. Good. Amazing. Squeeze your hands together. Great. Now, I want you to look at your thumbs. I want you to look if the right thumb is crossed over the left or the left thumb is crossed over the right. You got it? Okay, everyone whose right thumb is crossed over the left, hands up. Okay, everyone whose left over right, amazing. Okay, so let me break this down for you. Statistically, if your right is crossed over your left, you're in the top 50% of the most beautiful people on earth. Yay, so congratulations to you. If your left is over the right, then you're statistically in the top 50% of the most intelligent people on earth. Okay, so congratulations to you guys as well. Okay, that makes my job equally hard because we've got a balance here. So I want to ask one question. How many of you think that winning in sport is harder than winning in business? Hands up. Just 3, 4. Okay. And how many people think winning in business is harder? Fewer people. All right. That's interesting. And there are a lot of people that are sitting on the fence. So I'm going to ask this question again, and hopefully we'll get an answer. But there's something interesting about the world of sport. I'll tell you what it is. The first thing is that the margin for error is minuscule, tiny. Okay. The penalty for failure is very, very high. What do I mean by this? I mean that if you take the Olympic Games, for example, the difference between position number one, where you get the gold medal, and position number four, where you get nothing, is 0.5%. And 0.5% in the 100-meter finals is 1/100th of a second. 0.5% in the marathon, 42 kilometers, is 3 seconds. So everyone do this. Good. So that click is 3/100th of a second. So before you do that, three people have gone past the finish line in the 100-meter finals. So this is what I mean by the margin for error is so small. And what do I mean by the penalty for failure is high? Anyone knows who the fastest 100-meter sprinter in the world is? Again? Very good. Anyone knows who the second fastest is? Exactly. That's the difference. That's why the penalty for failure is so high. Okay? Because everyone knows Hussein. And Justin Gatlin, who's less than 1/100th of a second slower, is not a name anyone will ever remember. So that's the beauty and the exciting thing about sport. The other exciting thing about sport is that sport's a pure meritocracy. When we start, everyone starts on 0-0. Right? And we have a set amount of time to play, and then we determine a winner. Beautiful, really, really beautiful. The thing about an athlete that's really amazing is every athlete has a coach standing right next to him. He's like a life GPS. That's what I call myself, a life GPS. If you're using Google Maps and every time you take a wrong turn, he doesn't scold you, he just shows you a path how to come back. That's what we do. You know, we just show them how to course correct, show them how to course correct. No judgment, no anger, nothing. We just bring them back on track. Imagine that. You know, we're just there all the time. Athletes spend 70% of their time failing. The greatest athletes on the planet have only succeeded 30% of the time. That's the amazing thing about sport. The other amazing thing is we spend only 30% of our time competing. And we spend 70% of our time practicing. The other beautiful thing is that we may be practicing the exact same skill for our entire life. We use the word mastery in sport, in art, in music, because they're practicing the same thing over and over and over again. Okay. And the playing field never changes. The dimensions of the court, the game, the field, the pitch never change. So these are the exciting things about sport. And my whole life, I thought sport should be the holy grail. And then recently, I've been thinking, and I was thinking to myself, and I was feeling very sorry for everyone in the business world. And the reason I'm feeling sorry for you is because you spend 100% of your time competing. Right. There's no way. Where do you practice? Where do you step away where you can practice a skill that no one's looking at, no one's judging, and you come and show? From 8 to 5, Monday to Friday, you're in your competition environment. Most of you do not have a coach, so you have no life GPS. You don't have a person standing by your side, right, who's telling you what you're doing right and what you're doing wrong. Okay, and it's tough if you don't have someone to just guide you, because how are we supposed to know all the answers? Business is not a pure meritocracy. You're competing against someone who started way before, and you're competing against someone who's just starting now. You're competing. The hardest thing about business is that how do you play a game when different people are playing by different rules? How do you play this game? It's got to be the hardest thing when you're trying to play fair and the people out there who are not playing fair. That's got to be extremely difficult. The thing that's hard about business is that your entire playing field changes. 2 years ago, we were all in person, you were meeting your clients, and now your playing field's changed. Everything's digital, you don't know where your threats are coming, you have no idea. Okay? And you've got to master not one skill, you've got to master multiple skills to succeed. Okay? Right. So now, let me ask you this question again. How many of you think, right, that it's harder to win in business than it is in sport? Yeah? Few people. No one's mind has changed. That's okay. that's fine. So when I deliver any talk for any organization, okay, I like to study that organization, everything. And since I'm here to talk about the psychology of peak performance, one of the areas that I started looking at was the value system of DSP. What are the core values of it? I said, you know, let me start there because that's an important part. And I found four values and I thought, whoa, these four values are very, very strong to the psychology, or they form the foundation of peak performance, actually. The first one, in your words, is called honest asset management, you know. And the asset, in my word, is the person himself. And what does honest asset management mean? Honest asset management means that you live your true values. You live your authentic self. You bring it there to the front. That's what honest is. Okay. And do you know why this is so pertinent? Because the hardest thing to do in sport is to convince an athlete to leave everything on the field. It's the hardest thing to do. You may think that he spends his whole day training, that's the easiest. No, it's the hardest thing. Because what happens if he tries his best and he's not good enough? Then what? What does he go home and do? How does he look at himself? How does he wake up the next day and go? So it's always easier to just keep a little bit in the bank. That's the hardest thing. But honest asset management is about showing up in the best version of yourself every single day. And one thing I've realized about success is that the only way you can succeed is if you bring your core personality, who you are, to work every day. If you are two different people, a different person at work and a different person at home, or a different person, you've got zero chance of success. You'll be burnt out before the decade's over. Okay. So honest asset management was one of the fundamental things. And the way to actually do that is to really own and understand your pain. The second one that really stood out for me, do good, be good. It's like, whoa. For me, I lecture value-based leadership. I do it at the Stanford Business School at the LEAD program. Okay. Values are the essence of everything. Values, there's a difference between beliefs and values. Beliefs is what someone else tells you. Beliefs are your religion, your culture, your caste, your mom, your dad, your uncle, someone told you something. That's a belief when it's handed down from someone else. And the problem with beliefs is when you try to live your life in accordance with that, what happens is you never ever feel fulfilled. Values come from inside. Values are enduring. They can take on anything. That's the beauty of it. So do good, be good is about really leading a life of values. Leading a life. And when you connect that value to a higher purpose, it becomes absolutely significant. And now we get to the really exciting ones. The exciting value that you'll speak about is knowledge. And in my world, it's called evidence-based data. But I'll tell you something about data that we say in sport. Data is like a bikini. What it reveals is exciting. What it hides is crucial. Right? This is the saying we have. It's really, really important to study everything, but understand the relationship between all of this. Data is a fascinating subject. I'll tell you a story. Many years ago, I was coaching a player that you all know. His name is Hashim Amla. He was probably, he got to the number one test batsman in the world. And for the longest time, we struggled to get him into the ODI team. ODI cricket. And the reason we struggled to get him in was not because he was a bad batsman, but because he was a poor fielder. He kept dropping catches at night. Right? And when you look at all the data, he kept scoring a lot of runs. And you look at the spreadsheet, you looked at the data, you tested his eyes even, it looked fine. Right? But with data, you have to understand how to read between the lines. Okay. So why would a player who's scoring runs when he's at the crease drop catches when he's in the field, especially at night with lights on? Okay. Now what data didn't tell anyone and what everyone missed and where we had to find the gap between it is that it takes between 300ths to 800ths of a second for the ball to travel from the bowler to the batsman. And in that time, you don't have to blink. But if the catch goes up in the air, it could have a hang time of between 5 seconds to 18 seconds. And it's not possible to not blink there. Okay. Now, what happened is Hashim had what was called a dry eye syndrome. Right. So under the lights, his eyes used to get dry and he used to blink a lot. So when the ball went up, because of the lights and his eyes were drying, he would blink a lot and he'd lose focus. Because every time you blink, your eye nose goes out of focus for a second before it comes back. That's why he dropped catches. Now that is not in the data. You have to read between the lines to see that. And we got it corrected. We put collagen into the tear ducts, which allowed the eyes to stay more lubricated and the problem was sorted out. So the reason, the powerful thing about data is, I always ask everyone, and we ask ourselves this question every single day. Do we think something is important because we can measure it? Or are we measuring what is important? Many people make the mistake of, because a data point is given to them, they think that data point is important. And that may be pertinent, but that's the lazy approach. The approach for performance is to ask yourself, what is important for me to measure, and find a way to measure it. Your job is not to answer questions. Your job is to question the answers. Remember that. So that's knowledge. And the last value that was so beautiful was the value of processes in DSP. I'm going to tell you a story. I don't know how many of you like the game of rugby, but this is a very beautiful story. Listen to this. Okay. In 2011, it was the year of the Rugby World Cup. And New Zealand were the best team in the world. Okay. And they were the best team in the world because they had the best player in the most important position. That player was Dan Carter, and he was playing in the fly half. Supremely important. Now, before the World Cup started, two tests before in the practice match, Dan Carter fell, tore his ACL, and he's out for the tournament. The most important player gone. So they brought in a replacement, and that replacement was Aaron Crudon. Two games into that, he fell, hyperextended his knee, and he's out for the tournament. So now the third choice is playing in the most important tournament with the home favorite. His name was Colin Slade. So the coach phones a guy by the name of Stephen Donaldson, and he tells him, hey, come and join the team. And this guy's busy fishing because he had no chance of playing here. This was an absolute miracle that he even got there. Right? He came. New Zealand won the semifinals. They got into the, quarterfinals, got into the semifinals, get into the finals. And in the finals, they're playing France. And in the first half of the final, New Zealand are leading 5-0. So this is how the scoring works in rugby. If you score a try, it's 5 points. Then you get a kick, and that kick can earn you 2 points. It's called a conversion. But if something happens in the game, you get a penalty, and if you score that, it's 3 points. So 10 minutes into the second half, what happens is Colin Slade falls down, gets hurt, and they get a penalty kick. And that penalty kick can take the score to 8-0. There's only one man in the entire squad that can kick the ball 30 meters to the goalpost. And that man has not played a single minute in the entire tournament at all. Right? And they have no other option but to get him on. Okay. And Stephen Donald goes and he kicks the ball and it floats through the goals and he scores it. And France do score another try and they do convert the kick, but New Zealand won that World Cup 8-7. Now, why am I telling you the story? I'm telling you the story because Stephen Donald, even though he was not going to play any game, he showed up every single day and he kicked 150 balls. Right? Now, why did he do that? He did that because the greatest travesty on earth is to get an opportunity you're not prepared for. That is the greatest travesty. So, when DSP and a coach and anyone else says process, what are we talking about? We're talking about showing up every single day and doing what you need to do. Not because it will entitle you to an opportunity, but because through the grace of God, if that opportunity comes, you don't want to mess it up. And in my world, an opportunity is like this, 1/100th of a second. Okay. Now, I found that these four rules were beautiful, beautiful rules around the psychology of peak performance, and I thought I'll add a little bit to it. I'll tell you a few really powerful, interesting stories around that. The first story I wanted to tell you, about is another amazing runner. And there's a beautiful lesson around it. I don't know how many of you would have ever heard of this name. His name was Edwin Moses. Anyone ever heard of Edwin Moses? Yeah? Edwin Moses was a 400 meter hurdler. He was the greatest runner of the entire decade. And the 400 meter hurdles is the toughest event in athletics. It's called the man killer event. Now, Edwin was a scientist and he studied all his opponents and he found something interesting. He found that some hurdlers were taking 14 strides between hurdles, okay, and some were taking 15. So Edwin Moses studied all of his opponents. I'm sorry about this break. And he noticed that some runners were taking 14 strides between the 10 hurdles and some were taking 15. So he took a simple decision. He says, I need to train, and the only thing I need to do is I need to take 14 strides between these hurdles. And if I execute this, no one will beat me. And that's all he did. 14 strides between hurdles. Everything he trained for was that. And Edwin Moses was unbeaten for 9 years, 9 months, and 9 days. He won 126 consecutive finals. Only because he executed one thing. Now, Edwin is an amazing person, and there's another powerful story that I'll tell you about. And that story is that in 1972, he was going to go to the Olympics, and he was going to race against a Ugandan runner by the name of John Akiboa. Okay. John Akiboa came from Uganda, and he held a record of 47.82 in the 400-meter hurdles. But the United States boycotted the Olympics. So Edwin Moses said to himself, not only will I win, but I will never run slower than 47.82 because I never want a person to come up to me and say, you never ran against John Akiboa. So he ran 126 finals, all of them under 47.82, right, by executing just a single task, 14 strides between hurdles. Now, why am I telling you this story? Most people in the world think they need motivation. According to psychology, no one needs motivation. What you actually need is clarity of thought. If you know what to do, your body, your mind will pull all of its faculties together and you will execute it. No one needs motivation. You need motivation to do what you don't want to do. You need motivation when you don't have clarity. Okay? So, the first thing about peak performance is clarity of thought. The next thing about peak performance. I spent some time doing some work with the greatest tennis player currently, Rafa Nadal. Right? Two Grand Slams ahead of everyone else, and we did some rehab on him. And I'll tell you a really interesting story about Rafa. Rafa tapes his fingers. You see it? Anyone watching play, you'll find fingers on his tapes. Now, the physiotherapist would do this. Now, Rafa arrives before practice, 1.5 hours before practice. He's in the locker room, getting his ankles and his knees taped and fingers taped and stuff. But the thing is that you never know if the taping is done right until you hit a ball. Okay? You just don't know if it feels right until you hit a ball. It could look perfect, but it could not feel perfect. Okay. Now, one day, we go out to practice, and within 30 seconds, it was feeling uncomfortable. So, he came back, he sat down, he pulled it out quickly, he asked me to get some tape, he shoddily tied it up again. Okay. And then we went on and we practiced, and I didn't think anything of it. But something amazing happened the next day. The next day, he came into the locker room 2.5 hours before practice. And he's just sitting there, and he's got nothing to do. The team, half the team are not even there. Right? And as we're coming in, he's there, and asking me, I say, hey, Rafa, why are you so early? Okay. And he says, my tape didn't feel right. So I said, yeah, but that's okay. We could get it done. We'll get it done this time. He says, yeah, I just wanted to give the physio more time. He said that maybe the physio didn't get it right because I didn't give him enough time to get it right. So I came earlier. That is the psychology of a champion. taking full accountability and full responsibility for every single decision in your life. The moment, the second you look outside of yourself, you become a victim. You become powerless because you've given your power to everyone else. So the second important lesson, the first is clarity of thought. The second is to take full accountability and full responsibility of every single decision in your life. Okay. Now, as Yamini said, I spent some time working with the Kenyan marathon team, and the Kenyans are probably the best runners in the world for a very, very long time. So I'll tell you something about them. When you go to Kenya, we train in a little town called Eton. Eton is in the Guinness Book of Records for having the largest concentration of talent on the planet. It doesn't have more than 20,000 residents, but 96 of the 100 fastest times in the marathon event belong to residents of that village. There's no hotel, there's no street lights, there's nothing in there. We produce champions from there. And when you drive into Eton, there's a big board that says, "Welcome to the home of champions." That's what it's called. But this story is not about them. In early 2000s, two young New Zealand boys by the name of Jake and Zane Robertson were on holiday in Kenya. And somehow they found their way into Eton and they stumbled upon them. Young kids, just finished school, 16 years old. And they Google and they try to search and they try to see who's the fastest marathon runner from New Zealand, and no names popped up. So they had no career, they had no university, they weren't doing anything, so they decided to just stay in Eton for a little bit. Right? And they decided to train with the greatest marathoners that exist. And how the story goes is quite remarkable. These two kids who have absolutely no background in running, nothing, okay, stay with the greatest. And 8 years later, the brother, Jake Robertson, became the fastest Caucasian to run the half marathon. He became the first Caucasian also to break 60 minutes in the marathon. Okay. Now, why am I telling you this story? I'm telling you the story because in the world of sport, there's always this argument of nature versus nurture, your genes versus your environment. And the truth is that the environment always wins. So, what is the next lesson about peak performance? It's to become absolutely crazy about the people you spend your time with. If you are not absolutely mad about being diligent about selecting the people you spend time with, you've sacrificed everything. Why? Because your mind will subconsciously model the behavior of the people you spend your time with. So if you spend your time with people who are victims, always complaining about everything, you are going to complain. If you spend your time with people who take accountability, who become champions for themselves, people who like to take their own action, you will do the same. Right? So be extremely, extremely diligent with who you spend your time with. That's the third very, very powerful lesson about psychology of peak performance. I won't take too much time. I'll tell you just one or two more stories. I spent 4 years living in the temple as a monk, so I want to tell you a little bit about, it comes from a very spiritual place as well. There was a boy one day who was walking down through a forest, okay, and he comes across the sage who's sitting under this big tree, okay, he's meditating. The sage asks this boy, "Where are you going?" The boy says, "I'm going to see God." So he says, "Can you ask him a question for me?" The boy says, "Sure, what do you want to know?" He says, "Can you ask God, when will I get a chance to see him?" Okay. So the boy says, "Okay." And he keeps walking through the forest. And then he comes to a beggar sitting under a big tree. And the beggar asks him, "Where are you going, my boy?" He says, "I'm going to see God." He says, "Can you please ask him when I'll see him?" He says, "Sure, I'll ask him that." So the boy goes on his way and he meets God. He says, "God, I met two people and they asked me to ask you a question." So, he says, "Sure." He says, "Both of them want to know when will they get a chance to meet you." Okay. So, God says, "You tell the saint he's not going to meet me in this life. And you tell the beggar he's going to meet me very, very soon." But God said, when you give them this answer, they're going to ask you a question. They're going to say, "If you really met me, what was I doing?" So the boy started smiling and he says, what should I tell them? He says, you tell them that I was threading an elephant through the eye of a needle. So the boy started laughing. He says, sure, I'll go. So he goes back through the forest and he meets the sage. So he says, did you meet God? He says, yes. He said, you ask your question? He says, yes, but you're not going to like it. He says, you're not meeting him in this life. So the sage got angry. He says, okay, what was he doing if you met him? He says, he was threading an elephant through the eye of a needle. Okay. And the sage dismissed him, got angry, and he says, I don't believe you. What rubbish are you talking about? Get out of here. And he keeps walking down, and he meets the beggar under the tree. The beggar says, did you meet God? And he says, yes. And God says, you'll meet him very, very soon. And he got so happy, he started tearing. And he says, please tell me, what was God doing? And he says, God was threading an elephant through the eye of a needle. And the beggar broke out in this beautiful smile. And the boy was now confused. He says, do you believe me? He says, of course I believe you. And the beggar picks up a little seed from the ground and he says, if God can put this tree in this seed, why can't he thread an elephant through the eye of a needle? Okay. Now, this is a story about faith. Having faith. And what is faith? Faith is in your process. Faith is in something you cannot see. Okay. And sometimes to succeed, you don't need money and you don't need luck. You need conviction. Conviction in your process. Faith in your process. So the next lesson about peak performance is, if you have an iota of doubt in yourself, an iota of doubt in your process, and an iota of doubt in your ability, the chances of it manifesting are slim to none, right? You've got to have unbelievable faith and conviction in your process, because that's the only way it's going to come together. I want to tell you another, very quickly, cricket story. I'll take 2 minutes more. In 2003, I was working with the Indian cricket team at the 2003 Cricket World Cup. Okay. And you know, we lost in the final to Australia. But this is a story about the game we played in Kingsmead. Okay. We get to Kingsmead, and we're playing England. And for anyone who follows cricket very closely, Kingsmead is not a very nice wicket for subcontinent players. It bounces a lot, and it swings even more. And that happened to be my home ground. Okay. And we just come off 2 wins. India just come off 2 wins and we get to Kingsmead. And as a technical analyst, my job was to analyze the pitch and just give some strategy on how we're going to go forward. I was deciding whether which type of spinner to play, how should we go. And we made 2 important decisions at that game. The first decision we made was no batsman should try to keep the ball on the ground, which goes against the MCC coaching guidelines. Why? Because the ball bounces too much for our short Tendulkar and Dravid and Sehwag to try to keep the ball on the ground. They had no chance, right? So we said, the ground is small, use the air, go over the top, okay? Now that is against everything they know or knew at that time. The second thing we said was that Zahir Khan and Ashish Nehra have to bowl Yorkers. And we didn't mean Yorkers, but we meant bowl it really, really full. Because what happens when you bowl the ball really full is you give it a chance to swing. And that's the ground where it swings. But their natural length was very, very short. Okay. But both of them listened. Both listened. Sachin increased his stance, Nehra bowled wide. And we had one of the probably the most emphatic victories of that World Cup at that ground. Both of them opened up, got 50 each. And Ashish Nehra got his career best figures of 6-for-23 in 10 overs. Okay. Now, why am I telling you the story? I'm telling you the story because you have to evolve yourself, and this is a rule of sport. Change when you're winning, not when you're losing. Never, when you lose, you have to go back to what you know best. You have to go back to your basics. Right? When you win, when you're winning, your confidence is at an all-time high. When you're winning, the gap between you and your competitor is greater. Right? That is the time to take risk. Right? So we call it the sigmoid curve. It's a psychological science that shows how if you evolve on the way up, increase the shelf life of a skill. Okay. Now, all of this around performance is very, very important, but I want to end with one beautiful, it's a shloka, which I'll translate for you all. I'll give you the explanation of it. Having spent 4 years in the temple, everything in my life comes down to this. Chapter 18, verse 14 of a book called the Bhagavad Gita, which is a conversation between Krishna and Arjuna. Krishna is explaining to Arjuna, what are the five things that are needed for success? And the first thing he says that's needed for success is, you need to be the right person for the job, which means you need to be competent. And competence is in abundance. Every one of you in the room is competent, right? There's a lot of competence. The second thing is you need to be in the right place. The right person needs to be in the right place. Otherwise, success is not going to happen. You know, if Rafa was sitting in some other country, he wouldn't have won that open. The third thing is the right person, right place, and he needs to have the right tools available to him. Remember that. If you don't have the right tools, success is not going to happen. The fourth variable is you could have the first three, but Krishna is telling Arjuna, you need to put in the right amount of work, effort. Effort is needed, right? So the people who say that, you know, we're not going to work hard, everything's ordained in destiny. No, Krishna is telling Arjuna, you have to work hard. And he said, these four variables are in your control. But he said, there's a fifth variable that's not in your control. And that fifth variable, you can call it anything you want to. You can call it energy, you can call it luck, you can call it destiny, you can call it faith. What it's symbolic of is the thing that you did absolutely nothing about that helped this all come together. And every single one of us has it in our life. Whether it's introduction to someone, being in the right place, being navigated, having the right mentor, whatever it is, every one of us has that energy of something, right, that we didn't do anything about that has helped us nudge ourselves forward. Now, why is he telling Arjuna this? He says, because what is humility? Humility is the ability to recognize the fifth variable in your success. So no matter how successful you are, if you recognize the fifth variable, it will make you humble. And why am I telling you this? I'm telling you this because humility has always been, and I always coach this, is the foundation of learning. When you're humble, you will ask a question, you will ask for help, and you'll be open to learning from everyone. When you are humble, everyone is your guru. Very, very important. Okay. So these are some of the powerful stories and powerful lessons around the psychology of peak performance. And I've tried to weave it with narration so that you understand and absorb it. And I hope it was entertaining.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.